know people that are over there.
Yeah, and
it's
nobody
amazing
knew
what
that
they get.
all of a sudden, out of nowhere, the workers show up one day and start stripping off all the exterior siding and pulling down the exterior porches.
Oh my God, that's a disclosure.
And all of the sidewalks
that's...
have all buckled, so they're jackhammering them all out.
Yeah.
You know.
And they have the hours they're allowed to work, but still, you know.
Yeah, but well, they didn't come out of the porch.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't have enjoyment of your unit.
Yeah. Quiet enjoyment. It's a disclosure issue. They should have disclosed it.
Yeah, they've offered us, well, you could, you know, here's another unit you can move to.
Oh, great.
It's like, yeah, so we want to
move
again.
All your
right?
crap again.
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah. So what do you want? You want out of there, or you
I don't
want a discount?
Want anything. He was asking me, what's wrong? Is something on your mind? And I said, well, you name it. I've got a daughter who just had major back surgery.
Oh.
She's 5 days out of the hospital, and got a wife who's unhappy with our living situation because they decided to remodel it.
Yeah.
My remodel project is more than doubled in budget since I started it 6 months ago. And I've got a key employee,
well,
Debbie, who's just running roughshod over, you know, my clients and the rest of the office, and I just don't know how to handle it.
Oh, a client.
I'm not a manager of people. I just hire people, expect them to do their jobs.
Me too.
And now I got to figure out how I'm going to deal with this.
And she's an employee, Debbie.
So again, I'm just kind of. Yeah, so,
well,
so
I told
head.
You your budget of $2,500 for remodeling your house was a little small.
But you know what's so crazy about that business? Like for years and decades, I've been hearing people just say in a really sing-song way, like, "Yeah, I know. It's like double the cost, double the time."
Yeah, yeah.
And like,
but
how
it
do
always
you just
is.
Say that that's okay?
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes
like you start off at so low, that it's like it's gonna be.
Well, sometimes it's the contractor, but sometimes it's the changes we make. But still, they act like it's like. You know,
well, and here's the thing: I don't feel like any one person's ripping me off, but it's just like.
Well, let me get it at all angles. Let me ask you, why? You let's put it this way: can you figure out why the remodel is costing twice as much specifically, like? Is it change orders? Is it
because I was completely naive and unrealistic about what it cost to essentially rebuild an entire house from scratch?
Yeah.
Did you get a bid, or was it just kind of?
No, I did owner builder because I wasn't going to get ripped off by a contractor who was going to charge me $500,000 for a $300,000 remodel, but now I'm paying $500,000 for a $250,000 remodel.
I love how honest you are about that, because I did the same thing with my husband Ross. I didn't know what I was doing.
I've been 30 years in real estate. I'm humiliated and embarrassed that this is happening to me. It's hard for me to even admit that.
Well, it's the shoemaker with holes in their shoes, the cobbler with holes in their shoes, all that.
There are certain things you can't control.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I mean, listen, I'm the same way, but things just happen.
Yeah.
I know.
Okay.
Yeah.
But on the way down here, I was thinking about the show. I've got some great stuff.
Okay,
I mean, you know, obviously we talk about real estate, some great real estate stuff that's happened. But also, I mean, you got to start by talking about the stock market. It's so amazing what's happening.
So amazing. And how does that impact real estate? When will it impact real estate? You know, China, what's happening with all, there's so much Chinese money. How is that going to impact us? There was a $47 million sale this week, and the highest ever,
where?
Anywhere in Belvedere.
Oh, my God.
Belvedere.
Wow.
So I just got off the IJ.
So that closed?
With the IJ. No.
I saw you quoted in another article not too long ago.
I was.
You get quoted
well,
frequently.
Well, they stopped doing it because I used to be in every article, and somebody wired
here.
Complained.
Yes, this is Nadar Pourhassan.
Hi, Nadar, how are you?
Very good. I'm sorry I'm late. I'm in New York and the meeting is too long.
Yes, it's just okay. So we're just about to get started here. So just a couple of quick things because we're a business show, so we want to keep this business related. And I gave let me introduce you to a couple of people. Mark Pond is one of my co-hosts. And
hi, Nadar.
Hi, Mark.
Okay, and my other co-host, want to put your heads on, is Patti Cone. And
hi, Nadar.
Okay. Okay, so let's just go over a couple of quick things, because what we'll do is we're going to do, you know, roughly an 8 minute or so interview. What I'll do is I have just some opening remarks, and then I'm going to introduce you. And if I can pronounce your name, is it Nadar Pourhassan?
That's correct.
Okay. All right, good. I got
that right. Nadar, we were thinking, you know, we looked at the questions you sent us, and you know, if you don't mind, what I thought would be, you know, a little bit more, radio friendly, My first reaction when I learned of you joining us today was, you know what? You know, I read multiple newspapers a day and study the different industries, including investing in real estate. I haven't heard about HIV. I mean, you just never hear about it anymore. So I would love to, you know, and you've got some great information here. There's 1.1 million people infected with HIV. Well, it's newsworthy because the news isn't talking about HIV. So I think that's newsworthy. And then you obviously have a product that you're about to launch. We could talk a little bit about that. But we tend to like to ask kind of our own questions and I think you'll appreciate it. I think it'll be good. 8 minutes goes by pretty fast. So we'd like to get the word out. And if we can fit it in there, we'll probably talk a little bit about, how does this present an investment opportunity for our listeners who might be interested in, how to profit from these kind of medical breakthroughs.
Sure.
Is that okay? Yeah, that's great.
Awesome. Okay.
Mark, since you've got the thing there and you're doing great, I'm going to let you lead in with it. Okay.
Sure, absolutely. I'm happy to.
All right. Okay. So let me, okay. So when I, Nadar, when I say welcome to the best, when I say to you, I'll introduce you, I'll say welcome to the best in investing, then you can, say thank you very much.
What do you have for a lead-in intro? How are you going
to? I'm just going to say we have today, we have a special guest, Nadar Pourhassan, the CEO of CytoDyn. And then you just kind of, hey, I've noticed CytoDyn has to do with HIV.
Nadar, your company is this the only product that you have that you're about to launch, or do you have other products that also?
We have another antibody for HIV, but that one is not phase one yet.
So you specialize in this is so HIV is a specialty for this company?
Yes, it's a HIV specialty for us, and I'm gonna step out several on the month to get profit.
We definitely have to get a good signal from you.
Let me go to this.
Okay.
Much okay.
All right.
Now, is it
better? Yeah.
Okay, good.
In fact, because of our time, because we're starting a little bit late, let's just get right into it. Okay?
Sure.
Great.
All right.
Great.
Okay, so here we go. Welcome. You're listening to The Best of Investing on Talk 910. I'm your host, Edward Brown. I'm proud to have as my co-host, Mark Hunt of Pacific Private Money, one of California's fastest growing mortgage investment firms, and Patti Cohen of Pacific Union Realty. Our phone number is 888-912-1190. Now you're going to use that number to answer the trivia questions for 3 vacations given away during during this show. Excuse me. The vacations are not sponsored by the radio station, but by Lighthouse Resort and Marina, which is located 1 hour northeast of San Francisco. And those vacations are free. Their only request is a $75 cleaning fee to cover the housekeeping expenses. Today's trivia theme is, again, miscellaneous trivia. I'm going to keep you guys in suspenders on this one. Our website is bestofinvesting.com. Check us out on television, Comcast, Channel 26, AT&T, Channel 99, Saturdays at noon, Sundays at 6 p.m. Again, we want to mention our friends at Bangkok Thai in San Rafael. They were voted best 100 Thai restaurants in the U.S. Visit our friends Mally or Ben and tell them Edward sent you. They're very, very nice people and they will treat you great. I don't know if you guys have ever been there, but Bangkok Thai, right? San Rafael on 4th Street?
Yep.
Very good food. Very nice people. Excellent service. Okay, now today we have a special guest, Nadar Pourhassan, who is the CEO of CytoDyn. And Mark, you got some information on Nadar.
Yeah, Nadar, welcome to the Best of Investing.
Yes,
thank you for being here. So for our audience, CytoDyn is a company that specializes in treatments for HIV. And what I think is kind of interesting, Nadar, and maybe you can speak to a little bit about this. You know, I do a lot of reading, and I don't see a whole lot of articles or any press about HIV these days. In the last 10 years, it hasn't really been in the paper much, but this is still a very serious issue, a health issue in the United States, is it not?
Yes, for sure it is. And the medications out there right now, mainly from Gilead, very good medications. They are pills. There's about 27 pills that take care of HIV patients. However, in the United States, 1.2 million HIV patients, only 20% have complete suppressed viral load, which means if they don't have complete suppressed viral load, the rate of transmission of HIV is almost up 100%.
Wow.
They have complete suppressed viral load is almost zero. So why 20%? And that's the reason why there is 1,000 new cases of HIV year after year for the last 5 years.
So you're saying that 1.2 million people today in the United States have the HIV virus?
Correct, and that's in CDC, Center for Disease Control, has all the data from government, and everybody can check it actually.
Now what product are you currently in development that you hope to launch soon?
We are working on the first self-injectable antibody for the world of HIV. HIV has nothing but pills, and pills have to be taken every day at an exact time. If it's two or three or four pills, it will be very difficult to take it an exact time every day. And we have a solution to that.
Wow, that's
fabulous. I know, you have to take it at the same time every day.
Every day, and they actually have to take classes sometimes to make sure they don't miss the pill. It has to be an exact time every day. And when it becomes three, four pills, I mean, you can imagine how hard that would be.
Yeah.
Take it every day for the rest of their life.
Yeah, why is it that your body react a certain way if it doesn't take it at a different time each day?
Half life of the pills are in such a way that they have to take it again.
Before it wears off. Yeah.
Yes, exactly.
So tell us about when you hope to have your product on the market.
We have filed with the FDA our full protocol for phase 3. We have green light to do the whole phase 3, very short phase 3 program, because FDA believes in this product, has given us fast-track designation with accelerated approval. It was a special protocol of 300 patients only, which is almost unheard of for a phase 3. HIV, and only 25 weeks prior. So if we are able to hit all of our milestones, we should have our new drug application to FDA for final approval in November of 2020.
Okay, so Nadar, instead of people taking a certain pill every single day, you're giving them a shot, or are they drinking a serum?
Well, they could take a shot every week, and that shot is a sub-Q injection, very easy. Second injection. Our first approval is not just the antibody by itself, but it's in their conjunction with the pills. That's the only guidance that they have in such a product as FDA. So our second approval, which would be a study in parallel, which we are talking to FDA right now, is the only injection, and only injection we have been doing with 40 patients in our phase 2B, and now we have patients who passed the end of the study and are in extension, and they have gone suppressed viral load for 11 months without any pill. And the doctor who gave this, he was in San Francisco, Quest Clinical, Dr. J. Lorenzari at Quest Clinical, was shocked that he saw that the patients are staying completely suppressed without any medication. Quality of life has gone through the roof. They have reported that they see better, the energy is better, much higher, and the headaches are gone. So we have proven to FDA now that with our product, we were able to show that the toxicity that these drugs all have, we were able to overcome that.
Now, are there other companies like yours, Nadar, that are developing these kind of injectionable medications for HIV?
The only other company who's close to us, perhaps, is Thymed, the Taiwanese company. Dr. David Ho had a product called ibalizumab. That antibody, Dr. David Ho, by the way, was Magic Johnson's doctor, and he is the person who came up with highly active antiretroviral therapy in 1996. He became Time Magazine Man of the Year, a 12 honorary doctorate for that invention. And because of his invention discovery, there has been millions of lives saved. They asked 2011, what is the next medicine in HIV? And it's an antibody. They have one antibody, but it's IV setting. It's only for terminal patients. We are not only a self-injectable at home and sub-Q, but we also have many features that are better than ibalizumab, and their product is the only product that comes close to them.
So we're talking with Nadar Pourhassan, of CEO of CytoDyn. How's it pronounced? CytoDyn?
CytoDyn
company, which is bringing to market an injectable solution for those suffering from the HIV virus. And you cut out just a bit ago when you mentioned, you said November. Is it November of this year or November of 2016 when you hope to launch this product?
2016 is when we are hoping to file the NDA, new drug application, to FDA for final approval.
Yeah, is CytoDyn, is that publicly traded?
Correct, it is publicly traded, and it's been about 12 years or so that we've been publicly traded.
And has, when you announced this, has the stock, well, of course, the stock market had some plummeting issues recently, but
yes.
How has your stock performed?
It hasn't performed very well because we have not been doing any kind of visibility to the world. Because we were raising money, because of our success, we continuously had to raise money to make sure the trials go through. The last 6 months or so, our publicity has been almost zero, and we're just starting, and your show is probably one of the first ones that I have been getting.
There you go. Okay, we're on the ground floor.
So obviously you see some potential here for certainly accelerated stock growth once you get this product on the market, and if it's the success that certainly it appears that it will be.
Well, if you look at the final sales, if we are able to get approval and sell about $1 billion worth of sales, we believe we could generate some stock. And if you do the numbers, the way Wall Street prices based upon your revenue, the numbers are astonishing.
So, do you have the funding in place right now for the company to get this off the ground and get this mass produced?
We had announced that we finished a raise of $11.5 million recently with Boston Investment, and there are many bankers that we talked to. Their analysts are all very, very, shocked at the story. They have missed the story actually, and we are working to see who we would like to go with for our next fundraising.
Absolutely. So Nadar, for people who are interested in finding out more information about an injectable medical solution for those suffering from HIV, where would they go?
www.cytodyn.com.
All right.
Great.
They could always go to The Best of Investing and contact us by email if they want to get that URL again, that direct contact information. We're speaking with Nadar Pourhassan, CEO of CytoDyn, CytoDyn, and their development of an injectable HIV medical solution.
We're going to have to follow you and see what happens in November 2016, huh?
Definitely. Yeah. Appreciate you guys having me on.
Okay, Nadar. Thank you so much for joining us on The Best of Investing.
Good luck.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay. Yeah, Patti, you got to stop asking so many questions. Okay. So here we go with our first. That's kind of interesting. Okay, here is our first commercial break trivia question. Again, the theme is miscellaneous trivia. In what country was the bristle toothbrush invented? What country? All right. The first caller, we're going to do the first caller now. The first caller with the correct answer is going to win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. Which country was the first to invent basically the bristle toothbrush? All right, 888-912-1190. Stay with us, The Best of Investing. We'll be right back.
Good, interesting stuff.
Yeah.
So I pulled out stuff that you probably have already seen all these articles. So I get this email from a client who's one of my investors. CNN, homes are still selling like crazy in Northern California. This talks about the days on market that in San Francisco has the fewest amount of homes on the after 60 days.
Yeah.
This one, I don't remember where I got this from. Pending home sales in California, strongest gain in 6 years.
Yeah.
But then you get the Zillow report.
Yeah.
Home price growth is cooling.
Yeah.
Of course, everywhere else in the United States except the San Francisco Bay Area.
It is cooling here. And I mean, cooling is such a strong word.
U.S., month over month, it went down. Yeah, I mean, it it's almost statistically insignificant, but it's
yeah.
still,
yeah.
it's still, ah, you know, month over month change is actually down in the Zillow Home Value Index, and year over year it's 3%.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think part of it is for 3 years straight, we've had a rapid rise,
yeah.
and that's what happened last time, and then there's the, you know, what's going on, is this a bubble, blah, 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 and I wanted to talk about two trends around that. And then the stock market, what's happening with Chinese money, and
yeah.
how, what is the stock market affecting people right now?
Yeah.
And we did a poll in our company about, you know, what's happening with that. But the thing is, it is. I mean, when I looked at the trends, like I report the numbers to the IJ every Tuesday morning. And when I look at, you know, the month of July, this year versus last year, the median price was literally exactly the same, $1 off, $1,000 off.
Yeah.
So it's the same. And so, you know, what's happening, blah, 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 it's just leveling off, that's all.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Another thing that, you know, the IJ was about to write this story, and I said, that's not really even your story, because somebody pitched it to him, that the number of sales went up 11%.
Oh.
Well, it didn't really. I mean, we're talking about a very small sample. We're talking
yeah.
about July, blah, blah, blah. So there's a
yeah,
lot of stuff
10
going
to 11
on.
Is, you know, 10%.
It's ridiculous. Yeah. And so I also wanted to talk about the affordability index
sure.
and what that means. And then also, you know, the millennials, it's the lowest home ownership percentage
yeah, yeah.
in history.
Wow.
What does that
yeah.
mean? Why
yeah.
is it?
Good.
What it means
very
is
good.
Be a landlord.
Yeah.
Are renting.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
And then also the general population of how the baby boomers are getting older. What does that mean? You know
okay.
what I mean? So
no, that's all
that.
Really good.
So it's
stuff.
All like three or four different things, but whenever we can fit one of them in.
Yeah.
Or all
well,
of
let's
them.
Let's
so
start
we
with
we
the stock market just because it's
okay.
It's fun.
Yeah.
Let's see. So Mark, and when it comes to email time, will you do second mortgages? If yes, what's the highest LTV you go?
Okay.
Patti, what is your geographic region you are taking a listing? How would you handle listing that is out of your area?
That's what it is.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. It depends on the price range.
Yeah. Good point. Yeah, you're not going to take a $50,000 clear lake.
However, but I'll answer that. Yeah.
Okay. Here we go. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. Again, I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hahn and Patti Goin. When we cut to the first commercial break, we ask this trivia question. In what country was the bristle toothbrush invented?
Didn't they used to use camel hair initially for, like, toothbrushes?
If
that's true, would it be, like, you know, somewhere in Arabia?
No,
back
not,
in the day,
no
or?
Not this one. Any idea, Matt?
All right.
China.
China,
you know,
wow.
I'm guessing it must have get all that rice out.
Look at that camel's
yeah,
toothbrush.
All right, so Mark, you wanted to start off talking about the stock market.
Oh, well, of course. I mean, you can't have a show about investing and not talk about the stock market.
That's
I mean,
true.
What happened this week? You know, Monday and Tuesday, the stock market goes down 1,000 points. Wednesday and Thursday, goes back up 1,000 points. Just kidding, guys. Just want to see if you were all awake out there.
Well, even
attention.
During the day, it was down 1,000 before it, like, only lost a few hundred.
Well, yeah.
I think, can we
call it
correlate the number of heart attacks in that
well,
period?
Well, I mean, really, you know, it's just like, you know, first we're worried about China, oh my God, and then not so much anymore, you know, at the end of the week. It's just, it's really amazing. And I thought there was a really kind of almost amusing article in the Chronicle on Thursday that basically said, well, the world which was supposed to end on Wednesday didn't. And it really goes on to just talk about, you know, almost nobody really knows at the end of the day what's going on, whether you're, you know, in the, you know, stock market or you're in the business of selling stocks. And they interviewed actually, you know, dozens of people for this article, and it's basically the consensus was, you know, I don't really know what's going on and why it's doing what it's doing. So it's stock market continued to do what it does best, which is confuse people. The average investor had no idea what was happening, and that put him in league with all the experts.
Good point. So what is an investor to do?
Yeah. Well, you know, I guess what's an investor to do is probably nothing, right? You know?
Right.
Now, I will say for, you know, just to, for full disclosure, I don't own a single share of stock.
Neither do I.
I don't either.
Yeah. Oh, really? Patti, I would have guessed that maybe you would have been a little bit diversified. It's so funny because, you know, look, what do all the financial planners tell you? Diversify. When I hear diversify, it's like, oh, right, so I'm supposed to invest in a bunch of stuff that's going to not make any money and maybe even lose money.
Yeah.
As opposed to stuff that we like to talk about here on the Best of Investing, which is, you know, the three of us, I know we're all fans of real estate investing. I'm a particular fan of mortgage investing, which is real estate related, but you're actually lending on real estate values. And then, of course, there's other real estate related types of investments like REITs and even stocks of, you know, real estate companies and construction companies. But yeah, we're just so it's interesting. The three of us here, we're probably very much amused by what happened.
But, well, I gotta say that. I mean, the thing that concerns me though is that eventually, when the market does what it does, stock market, it does have an effect on housing.
Well, of course.
So you know that does affect all of us because you know even the loans. You want to make sure you're doing conservative loans, which I know you are. But
well, in all seriousness, too, and Patti, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to step on you there. I knew you were going to say something, but you know, when the stock market drops like that, what it does, it's a psychological thing. So right now, we've got a market where there's a lot of cash buyers. There continues to be a lot of cash buyers, although the percentage of cash buyers in the whole mix of people buying real estate right now, it has been trending a little bit downward. But I, you know, in the back of my mind, again, I try to think of this logically, and that's probably a mistake. But I think about the people with cash, and they're like, I mean, they're human too. I mean, we all invest based on emotions. And when the stock market does what it did, had it not recovered, had it continued to trend downward, I was fully expecting, this could trigger something that might have cash buyers stay, you know, just pull back and say, well, wait a minute, maybe we should, you know, keep our money in cash. And sit on the sidelines and see how this thing shakes out. Because you're right, you're absolutely right. You know, we're in a world where, you know, everything seems to affect everything else. And, you know, a stock market crash, a tech bubble burst, you know, something like to that effect, that will absolutely impact real estate because it will impact the perceptions of people and what they do with their money.
Yeah, no question, everything is definitely related. I looked at a chart this morning from 1965 in the Bay Area through today of the stock market graph of where it went up and down and real estate prices. And they followed each other
very
completely.
Well,
very strong correlation.
One difference is they are following each other completely. Stock market went up 17 times in that since 1965. Real estate has gone up 34 times. So,
I mean, year over year?
Yeah, no. Completely. That all.
The spikes, the cycles.
The spikes. So, you know, so we at Pacific Union this week took a poll, an email poll between each other, a big, huge conversation about is it impacting anybody right now? Are sellers saying I better get my house on the market or I'm not going to get my house on the market or are buyers pulling back? And for them, you know, not. Surprisingly, not much right now, but there is a little bit. I mean, for example, I had a buyer negotiating on one of my to buy one of my listings, and they pulled back because it was going to be all cash. It was going to be a second home, and it's over $1 million, and it's a development project, and it the money was coming out of Apple stock. So I mean, who knows how much they have? They might have a lot of it, but if it's you know if you have half of what you had, whatever. But we won't see it on the street in real estate until we start getting a glut of inventory where, you know, there's, right now we're still working on a severe shortage.
Yeah, absolutely.
But if buyers start losing their jobs and buyers start losing their down payments, they stop buying and sellers, and they have to sell. So now we start getting, that's when we get dicey.
That's gonna be really frustrating. That must have been really frustrating for you. I'm sorry to bring
up. Oh, yes.
Yeah, I mean, just to, sorry to bring up a kind of a sore subject, but I can just imagine going, freaking stock market, if it just would have done anything, you would have closed the deal.
Well, think about it. I mean, just like every aspect of life is constricting and going up and going down. And it's just a flow. And I've been doing it for 3 decades now. I've been seen all the flows. You know, you stick in or you stick out. The other thing, though, to think about is if you're, like Mark talked about, if you've got money in the stock market and it's taken a bath, a lot of people start going to real estate.
That's true. And then that actually causes the stock market to go down further because it's less buyers and more sellers.
Yes.
Well, let's not forget, you know, interest rates. So what was all over the news this past week? Well, maybe now the Fed, thanks to this market volatility and a little bit of a shock to the psyche of the consumer, now they're talking about maybe not raising interest rates come the September meeting, and maybe it's going to be they're going to continue to push that decision forward. Let's just kind of see how this rides out, and that's in you know, personally, I think that's, you know, that's good
that's
news
good.
For the real estate market. And,
yeah. And rates have been so low for so long that we start getting a little twisted when it goes up a half a percent.
Yeah.
But let's not forget about, you know, the early 80s with, you know, 20%, 18%. When I got in the business 27 years ago, it was a thrill to get anything under 10.
Oh, yeah.
So, you know, rates go up a little bit, okay. You know, it's
yeah, but percentage-wise, though, when it goes
yes.
from 3.5 to 4, you suddenly go, whoa!
Exactly.
Well, and
yeah.
you know, now that we've, you know, transitioned from the stock market back into the real estate market, you know, what's interesting is that even though we know how hot and how on fire Bay Area real estate has been and continues to be with no let up in sight, Zillow, which has their what they call the Zillow Home Price Index, is reporting that nationwide, the evidence is that home prices are cooling, and in fact, month over month, we had for the first time in 4 years, the Zillow Home Value Index went down. Now, it only went down 0.1%, so that could be a statistical anomaly, but basically they're saying that home value appreciation is leveling off, and year over year nationwide, it's now down to 3% from 4%. So we, of course, they look at that as good news, and I do too, because I think, you know, a double-digit price appreciation is not sustainable and not healthy overall for the economy,
right.
But notwithstanding the U.S. market as a whole, you know, we're here broadcasting live in the Bay Area, and we're still experiencing double-digit year-over-year price appreciation.
Right, and I think we have to look at it in a really big-picture perspective in terms of timing as well, because, you know, people are talking about, wow, in July, the number of sales have finally gone up, or the prices have stabilized net-net. Prices are not going up at the rate they have for the last 3 years, and that's really a good thing, because
yeah.
it took a huge roller coaster ride up, and we want to stay up there for a while. So if we just stay up there and glide, it's going to be really fun, you know. And at the same time, it's the slowest summer I've experienced in many years, and yet it was also by far the most intense spring I've ever seen. So the media likes to talk about, oh, what happened in July.
Well, maybe because it was so buoyant in spring, maybe
exactly.
that's where buyers were.
Exactly. Let's not talk about what happened in July. Let's look at what the last 3 or 4 or 5 months have been doing. Where were we 5 years ago? What happened when we started to go up 3 years ago? All that stuff. So, you know, there's nothing much going on except that we're doing well. And no, there's not going to be a bubble because net-net we still have the best job market in the country.
Okay. Tell you what, we're going to cut to our second commercial break. When we come back, we got a couple of very interesting emails from listeners here. Okay, so here's our second trivia question. Which inventor was quoted as saying, genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration? The first caller with the correct answer wins a free 3-day Do Night Stay.
Somebody was smelly.
Yeah. The first caller with the correct answer is going to win a free 3-day two-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Call 888-912-1190 to answer that question. We'll be right back.
That's great.
I can't resist that one.
Okay.
So the other thing I was looking at is that we have right now twice the number of people, the Americans,
yeah.
twice the number of people, 65 to 74, than we did in 2010. And, you know, so if you think about where we're going to be in 10 years, so what does that mean? So two things is, one is you want to look
at... Cane sales will go up.
Yeah, you want to buy one-story homes.
Oh, yeah, right.
You want to buy one-story homes.
What's trending.
And that's kind of what I'm thinking. I mean, it's always, and it's been like that. And one-story homes are more in demand than ever because the trend has been to build as few as possible. Of them as possible because it's more expensive to build one-story homes.
Of course.
If you can get a 2,400 square foot house in this like 4,000 square foot lot
yeah, right.
as a two-story. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So anyway.
I thought this was interesting, just kind of going back to the stats, because pending sales, because that's always a pretty
good,
that's a forward leader, you know, usually, and I thought that was pretty interesting that, and again, this is California-wide, so I don't really know.
Yeah.
Oh, no, it says on a regional level, pending home sales in SF were up 9% year over year, so.
In July, the month of July.
Month of July. So I guess that probably recognized, you said spring was a really hot market. So obviously a lot of sales went, a lot of transactions went into contract in July.
Yeah. Well, and I do have the year over year gains by county. So we can,
Year over year by county?
Yeah. So if we look at the year over year gains by county, then we can really start understanding what's going on. And then what else? And then the affordability is an interesting thing, too. Like, for example,
Okay. Ready?
So we'll do the email and then we'll just go back into it.
Yeah.
Second,
exactly.
Yeah.
Fourth segment. We'll do it again.
Here we go. Well, welcome back to The Best of Investing. Edward Brown here along with Mark Hunt and Patti Cohen. When we cut to the second commercial break, we ask this trivia question. Which inventor was quoted as saying, "One genius is 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration"? What smelly inventor was that? Mark would point out.
I don't know.
Thomas Edison.
That's because he's from New Jersey.
Wasn't he from Jersey? Okay, a couple of interesting emails here. So Mark, this guy asks, and it's a guy who wrote it, so that's why I can say this guy, not this gal. Will you do second mortgages, and if yes, what's the highest loan to value you go?
So for you new listeners, I'm Mark Hoff. I'm broker and president of a company called Pacific Private Money. We make private money loans, private money real estate loans more specifically, mostly here in the Bay Area. We're a local company. We make bridge loans and loans to flippers and rehabbers and other people who can't get bank financing. We call ourselves the Plan B when your Plan A doesn't work. So we're a non-bank source of financing. It's called Pacific Private Money because we use private investors who are interested in earning 8% or more on their money year in and year out, secured by deeds of trust on local Bay Area real estate. And the market for this type of product, you know, we're oftentimes called hard, you know, oh, you're one of those hard money lenders. Well, you know, yeah, we still get called that, but I prefer private money. The term private money, as George Bush would have said, it's the softer, easier name. Yes, kinder, gentler name. That's a kinder, gentler, right? And but hard money, private money, you know, essentially the same thing. But, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, that market was mostly seconds to people who were in some form of financial distress and they couldn't get a second on their home. They would go to a hard money lender. They'd get a, you know, usually a high loan to value second on their home. And, you know, and if they didn't pay it off, then the hard money lender would, you know, have to foreclose. Well, fast forward now to 2015, and ever since 2008, post-real estate market correction, that has not been the case. Most of the loans that we make in the private money realm now are actually first position purchase money loans or refinance in first position. We don't do that many seconds, and it's not because we don't do them, because we do. It's just that the demand for non-bank financing has really transcended from seconds to I need a purchase loan that I can't get from my bank, and so we're doing a lot of short-term bridge loans these days. Now, we do make seconds, and there are a lot of people with a lot of equity in their homes, and so even though seconds have fallen out of favor among those who invest in our product, so among my investors, all things being equal, they would much rather invest in a 70% loan-to-value purchase money first position loan, then they would say a second, maybe a $200,000 loan behind a $500,000 first on a $1 million valuation. That would be $500,000 plus $200,000, that'd be $700,000 on a $1 million. That'd be a 70% combined loan to value. Now, we'll make a 70% purchase money loan all day long because the borrower is coming in with 30% down or $300,000 if it were a $1 million transaction. But when they are asked to borrow in second position, that's a much different situation. If you're looking to borrow $200,000 behind a $500,000, well, now all of a sudden, you know, you're basing it on, you know, the market value. Maybe you didn't pay $1 million for it. Maybe you paid far less than that, but you've got a $500,000 first, and you're looking to pull out equity.
But even if it's on a purchase, sometimes, you know, you still get a little wiggy about being 200 behind 500.
Yeah. So what's the maximum loan to value or combined loan to value that we would do if we were considering a second? Well, we normally don't ever want to go above 70. And on a second where you're pulling cash out, oftentimes we don't even like to go above 60 or 65%. It really kind of depends on the nature of the person borrowing, where the house is located, how strong the market is in that particular area. Like, for example, we're in San Francisco, the peninsula. Market values are pretty solid right now. Although I will say we have turned down seconds in some of these booming markets because we're afraid that what if there is, you know, a correction.
Yeah.
Some of those homes that have gone up considerably in value, I'm a little bit nervous that maybe they'll, you know, maybe they might be among those who go down maybe 10 or 15%.
And it doesn't even have to be a cash out second. It could be just someone who wants to refinance a second, and you still get, you know, a little bit too, want to be very conservative on that.
So the answer to the question is it depends. And
okay.
Not to be sound like an attorney about it.
But the answer is yes, you will do seconds.
Of course.
Under certain circumstances.
Yeah, and not every brokerage in my space, in the space of private money loan origination, not everyone will do seconds. Some of them only do first nowadays, so you can. So you have to kind of shop around and call around. But for more information, if you're looking for alternative to bank financing, we can pretty much tell you over the phone during just a short conversation whether or not your situation is one that we can help you with. It's very quick and easy and painless to pick up the phone and call Pacific Private Money at 415-883-2150. If you're one of those who are afraid of being sold something that or talking to one of our guys, go ahead and just go to our website at pacificprivatemoney.com. That's pacificprivatemoney.com. Fill out one of our you know, contact forms, and we'll get back to you via email.
Okay, very good. And Patti, we got one here for you. It says, what is your geographical region that you take a listing, and how would you handle a listing that is out of your area?
Oh, I love that.
Because people love you so much that they maybe, you know, want you to sell all over the place.
So nice, and I'd love to sell all over the country. And what I definitely can promise is that I only take listings where I know I will be the best person for the job. So that being said, I'm Patti Cohn from Pacific Union, and I'm mostly based in Marin County. I do a fair amount of business in Napa as well. I own property there. What I do when I work outside the county is co-list with a strong, experienced, cutting-edge agent there. And I know so many in all of the nine county Bay Areas.
See, that's a good point, because you're so well known here that I would think that, you know how like on Shark Tank when Kevin O'Leary says, hey, when I call, everyone takes my call.
Yeah.
I bet you're kind of the same way. When you talk to another agent in you know, Sonoma, they'll say about Patti. Oh yeah, I know her.
I'd like to believe that.
Yeah.
Thank you so much. So yeah, so what I have a really strong base of other agents in different counties, and what that means to the consumer is, for example, in Napa, I have, you know, five listings right now over a million. We just closed two. I co-list with a local agent, and what that means to the homeowner is, if you, over half of the buyers for properties over a million in Napa County come from Marin, San Francisco,
yeah. Oh,
and
yeah.
Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
So as a homeowner, you now have two agents for the price of one working for you,
gotcha.
Exposing your property in a deep-rooted way.
Yeah.
And it's a no-brainer. Why would you not go for that?
Yeah. That's
so
really smart.
Yeah. So I work outside the county and I co-list with a local agent.
Seller
gets two for the price of one.
Yeah.
And there's many agents that would like to do that as well. I'm happy to do two for the price of one, and there's many agents
yeah.
that I work with. We share the expenses, we share the marketing, and the agent and the seller gets so much more for the money.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very
so that's
good.
The answer.
So what in your geographic region? I mean, you do Sonoma,
Napa, San Francisco, sometimes Contra Costa County, sometimes the San Mateo, Silicon Valley, and co-list that way.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, because I can see that where a lot of buyers might be from Marin. You have good contacts here in Marin.
Exactly.
Okay.
The name of the game is exposure, and if you can expose it for two for the price of one,
yeah.
Why not?
So anybody thinking about listing their property might want to give you a call. How do they get a hold of you?
I think they would love to. It's Patti Cohn, C-O-H-N, Pacific Union, 415-722-4842.
Okay. You can also see her on the Best of Investing website.
Got it. Thank
Very
you.
Very good. Okay. So here is our third final trivia question. Which British Royal was depicted on the first adhesive postage stamp? The first caller with the correct answer is going to win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Call 888-912-1190 to answer this question. Which British Royal was depicted on the first adhesive postage stamp? Stay with us. The Best of Investing will be right back.
Nice. Wow, it's going so fun and fast.
Mm.
Love that.
Because we're so good.
Yeah.
Because we're not so good. How's Christina doing?
Her pain's going down.
That's good. Little by little.
How old is your daughter with the back?
14.
14? Did she fall or something?
No, she was diagnosed with scoliosis during a growth spurt that happened just this past year. Her back went from perfectly straight to having a 40% curve.
Wow.
Yeah, so
being a dancer, that's...
a dancer. You know, my stepdaughter, when she was around that age, she wasn't diagnosed that way, but she was a dancer also, but she was having serious curvature and back problems because of those, and she's tiny, those heavy backpacks.
Yeah.
So that's part of it, too.
Yeah. Yeah, Sarah was kind of dealing with that. She played softball, and she saw a good physical therapist who kind of helped on stuff, but she didn't have an operation.
And in my daughter's own words, it is social suicide to have a backpack on wheels. Nobody will do it.
I
but you know what, though? Is she going to wear a brace while she's at school?
She has to wear a brace and she can't carry any books.
So I mean, people are going to expect to have that. Yeah,
they're expecting you. Go for it.
It's not going to be the same.
That's interesting. Wow. Poor darling. So now she's going to be fine, though, after recuperating?
Yeah. It's a 3-month recuperation.
Wow, 14-year-old daughter, you must know nothing anymore. You used to be so smart. A lot of eye rolling.
Yeah, I've got a 20-year-old and a 14-year-old. So.
Oh my God, I have a
17-year-old. Now my daughter's going to my son went to Chapman. He graduated. His oldest daughter, who was there.
Wow.
And then my daughter, you just dropped her off there.
Just dropped her off. Is she that age already? My son's just about to go to New York in January.
Wow.
Can't wait to get rid of them.
Crazy.
It's nasty.
Okay, we got a nice long segment here.
Good. Patty's got lots of stuff.
Yeah.
I got some stuff.
All right, I'll turn right over to you, Patti. How's that?
Okay.
Okay, here we go. Welcome back to the Best of Investing. Last time for today, I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hahn and Patti Cohn. When we ask this, we cut to the commercial break, we ask this trivia question. Which British royal was depicted on the first adhesive postage stamp?
Elton John. Queen Elizabeth.
No, you're getting close, though. Queen Victoria.
Ah,
not bad. Not too bad. All right, Patti, take it away. You got some other good stuff to talk about.
Yeah, I mean, if you're thinking about investing, where do you put your money? And the stock market's falling down, whatever. There's two trends I've been thinking about recently and wondering how it might translate to the listeners. So, for example, lowest home ownership rates in history. You know, not so much about why, but what do you do about it? I mean, I think why millennials are taking longer to grow up. They're not really interested in buying too much anymore.
It's like they're not getting their license either.
They're not getting their driver's license. They're
like,
just kind of like, well, I don't need this. I mean, and they want to be free. They want to travel. So they're not going to, settle down for 30 years. They're going to, anyway. And a lot of them can't afford it. So there's that. And then we're still coming out of the recession of the people that lost their house, and it's also on the heels of the first time and the biggest dip in real estate prices in years. So even if you can afford it, some people are saying, I'm not going to get burned again.
Yeah.
But what does that mean, right? Our population is shrinking and they have to live somewhere. So I say, be a landlord. So buy real estate in places where, in nice little neighborhoods where people are going to want to rent. Buy real estate in the city where, that's another story about
the cost of that.
The cost of that and all that, but and the rules and all that. But buy real estate, be a landlord, because people do need to live somewhere.
That's it.
Yeah. And you know, that doesn't necessarily mean buy the best house on the block necessarily. It's buy smart, okay? So the numbers work better. So that's one trend I'm seeing and making, you know, hay while the sun shines. The other thing that I find absolutely fascinating, and it's all about us boomers. So by 2030, a quarter of our population is going to be over 50. And
wow,
currently 39 million Americans are 65 to 74. So what does that mean? It's twice the number from 2010. That's only 5 years ago.
A little scary. Right away, I'm thinking Social Security, Medicare.
Yeah,
you know.
We're an aging population, very quickly aging.
Yeah. I mean, so where do you invest? Invest in elevators. There's a lot of two-story homes out there.
You know what? Yeah. That's not a bad idea. We kind of laugh, but that's not a bad idea.
Home elevators are not that expensive. You can go from 15,000 up to 50, basically.
Yeah.
But that's one idea.
Little lifts that go on the stairs. Those are about, what, $5,000 or $7,000?
Yeah. Whee! Yeah. Anyway. I saw that commercial. She looked so happy going on.
Yeah.
Right.
I will. They go about 1 mile an hour, but still, yeah. By the time you go downstairs, you forget why you went downstairs. You have to go back
exactly.
up again.
Oh, I forgot my glasses.
Yeah, that's it. Or just forget why. Right? Why did they even come downstairs?
Exactly. So what do you do? Okay, we're all aging. First of all, invest in single story homes. Because
older people don't want to walk up and down the stairs, right?
Yes. And I'll tell you what, younger people don't want to walk up and down stairs. So more and more, there's more demand for single-story homes.
Okay.
There's way more two-story homes, again, back to the elevator.
Yeah.
And at the same time, when builders build, they do probably 80% two-story homes,
yeah,
because it's a lot cheaper. You know,
you already have the footprint, you just build on top.
Yeah, if you can get a 2,000 square foot out of that
sure.
lot versus 1,800, you're going to make more money when you sell it. So I would buy those single family homes and be a landlord, and you know, the demand is there. And then the other thing that it all means to all of us in terms of real estate is construction. Construction companies modifying the houses. Everything.
Yeah.
So that's my 2 cents on investing and where you want to put your money. But buy real estate, be a landlord, and buy one-story homes.
And someone who is afraid to buy real estate now because they're afraid that maybe they lost the opportunity. So we've seen this robust price appreciation since 2012. We're wondering if we're nearing a peak at the end of 2015, going into 2016. When's the next cycle? You know, it's like the stock market. You don't not invest in the stock market if you're a stock market investor because you're afraid it's going to go down. You invest over time. You invest a little bit every month or every quarter, and over the long haul, you're going to be money ahead. And the same is always proven true with real estate. There will be another cycle. I mean, let's not kid ourselves and say real estate's not going to go down again. And let's not even suggest that real estate won't ever go down again like it did in 2007, 8, 9. It could. I don't think it will happen in the next cycle because I don't think the same factors are there. We don't have, we have low interest rates, but it's not easy money. We don't have a credit bubble that's driving real estate prices up. But if you can buy real estate, you can always make money. There's always an opportunity to make money in real estate no matter what the market is doing, whether it's going up, whether it's flat, whether it's going down. People who are contractors, rehabbers, and flippers, of course, understand that. For the average investor, again, you're looking at a long-term investment window, and you also always have to take into consideration, look at all the incentives the government gives you to invest in real estate.
Absolutely.
Write off the interest mortgage deduction, and your expenses, your property taxes that are related with that. Rents are continuing to go up. We've talked about maybe a pullback in real estate prices potentially. Which is, again, not a given that real estate prices are going to pull back. It's just that some people are wondering whether they're going to do that or not. The other thing is the rents. Rents have gone up. I don't know that, I mean, can you imagine a situation where rents would actually go down from where they are now? I mean, in the Bay Area, I certainly don't, based on where we live and the quality of the lifestyle. So it's, you know, again, if you look at the long haul,
a
five-year, 10-year investment window, or even longer, accumulating real estate is certainly, I think it remains one of the best and strongest wealth-building strategies available to any of us.
And let's not forget leverage. When
when
you compare against, say, the stock market, or you buy a piece of art, you're going to have to come in with 100% of the money, or it's not yours. But you can get in, people still get in with no money down on real estate up to $726,000 with an FHA loan, or you put 20% down, or you put whatever down, but you're still taking the appreciation based on 100%.
Yeah, and then the bank doesn't participate in that, and they're lending it to you at, you know, 4 or 5%, you know, or 3%.
Exactly, and the government gives you the interest mortgage deduction, and when you sell it as a married couple, you get a $500,000 exclusion as if it's your primary residence. I mean, we're just set up to buy.
That's right, and capital gains for, in some cases, on the gains of other ones.
Yep.
Mark, let me ask you, because we didn't get into deal of the week, I'm going to change subject here for a minute. Do you have anything special you wanted to share with us?
Well, interesting that I was actually picking up an email that I got from one of the investors in the Pacific Private Money Fund, one of our investors who is enjoying the 8% on an annualized basis payout that we make on our mortgage pool fund, which is used to fund some of our conservative real estate products that we offer to borrowers throughout the Bay Area. But he sends me this article from CNN, and of course this is just, again, just how the rest of the world is looking at the Bay Area. And the title of the article says, "Homes are still selling like crazy in Northern California." I forgot to tell you that this particular investor, his name is Bill, is currently living in Mazatlan. So he is retired. He made a bunch of money in the stock market in years past. And he's been diversifying into mortgage products, and he's one of the largest investors in our mortgage pool fund. And so he's reading a CNN article from his little home in Mazatlan, and says, title of this, he said, "Did you see this article, Mark? Homes are still selling like crazy in Northern California." And it's just talking about the fact that San Francisco is the hottest market in the country, where only 25% of homes are still on the market after just 2 months. And nationwide, that number is over 60% of homes after 2 months are still on the market. Well, in San Francisco, it's only a quarter are left still unsold. And you got to figure, what's wrong with those people? It's just like, did they just price that like crazy? Hold out for a higher price? So anyway, we're enjoying, you know, it's a wild ride, and we're enjoying it while we can. The other thing I wanted to ask Patti about was, you mentioned off the air, Patti, that there was the highest sale ever of a home this past week.
Just this week, $47 million sale in
Marin
County.
How many square feet?
Oh, it's a beautiful house.
Was that the one that was that the house that historical house that was almost on the top of the hill, kind of forward on Belvedere Island, facing San Francisco?
I think, well, there's a lot of them, but I think so. It's on Golden Gate. And in Belvedere, $47 million.
So that closed, right?
It's huge. I don't remember how many bedrooms, but I mean, it's just huge.
27 bedrooms
and 37
bathrooms.
Yeah. And it becomes, like, unlike other areas, it becomes less about size and more about view and location and ease and how much outdoor land you have. It's just a stunning price, no matter what.
You know, that's scary. You know, it's funny. I'll tell you why I wouldn't spend $47 million for a house, even though I could.
Even if we had it. Even though we could today.
It's because I don't want to pay $500,000 or $600,000 a year in real estate taxes.
Right.
To me, that's unconscionable.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. Maybe if you had $470 million, it wouldn't matter. And buy
something
for $47 million.
Go. You know how many starving children I could feed with $600,000 a year, rather than give it to real estate tax.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you asked me about deal of the week. Well, I'll tell you about a deal that we didn't do this week. This was an application for the purchase of a rather sharp-looking industrial building in Scotts Valley. Scotts Valley is a cute little town between San Cruz and San Jose.
Right.
And we looked at the pictures, and we do mostly single-family home purchases, but this guy was going to, you know, he wanted to buy this industrial building, and it's a two-unit building. He had a lease for one and didn't have a lease for the other. And It was kind of interesting. We didn't really find out until we started digging into it. What was the intended use for the second unused unit? Well, it turns out the buyer of this wanted to set up a marijuana distribution.
I was going to guess that. That's exactly what I was going to guess. Yeah.
So we turned that down, not because we're prudes, and not because I've never inhaled, but but because it's still not legal in California, and even though I doubt this would happen, it's still possible that the federal government could, if they didn't like this particular operation by this particular owner of the property, if there was complaints, they could shut it down, and they potentially could confiscate the property to the loss of my investors' capital if we let them.
Smart man, I wouldn't have touched that either.
Yeah, so you know, as much as I would like to be on the cutting edge and help out an entrepreneur,
not for that.
Yeah, never would I have imagined 40 years ago when I was a little bit living in Marin County and enjoying the fruits of what Marin County and lifestyle had to offer. If you had told me 40 years from now I'd be turning down a loan application for someone who just wanted to do a little bit of medical marijuana distribution, I probably wouldn't have believed it.
Yeah. I couldn't even believe that they would apply for a loan, years ago.
Well, that's, we've actually had 4 applications this year alone.
For that.
Wow.
And I will tell you that we actually tried to do one of them and learned that really none of our investors wanted to do it. And of course, then we investigated and talked to our attorney and found out, you know what, you don't even want to go there.
I mean, there's too many other good loans out there. Why would you, put yourself on
that's
that?
That's exactly right. That's good. The good news is that we get about 20 applications a day, and we say no to about 19 of them.
Yeah.
So that's this
was
another
choosy,
one.
Very
yeah,
choosy, which is why your investors have never lost money.
Absolutely.
Okay. So here's our thoughts for the day. You guys remember George Brett, the baseball player?
Mm-hmm.
So he said, if a tie is like kissing your sister, losing is like kissing your grandmother without her teeth out.
I heard that.
Hear
it's
that
so
one?
Good.
And Irma Bombeck. Now, Mark's not going to like this one, but Irma Bombeck, remember her?
Yeah, oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
She said, if a man watches 3 football games in a row, he should be declared legally dead. I said that because Mark likes football.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, tune in next week to The Best of Investing. We're going to be giving away more free vacations for answering trivia questions. Thanks for listening. On behalf of our team, I'm Edward Brown. We're wishing you the best of investing. So long.
Oh, that was fun. Awesome. Thanks for keeping my glasses for so long.
Yes, all this time.
I have to tell you, I got them at the dollar store, but I really like them.